Hi, welcome to the ninth video in the series where we will try to comprehensively demystify the double slit experiments. Let's quickly walk through some of the experiments and effects that are considered unintuitive. Wave particle duality first. When you send lots of particles through a double slit, they interfere with each other and behave like a wave. But particles are countable entities. When observed, they are in one place. Single particle interference. When you send the particles individually through a double slit, one after the other, they still eventually produce an interference pattern. So what does each particle interfere with? A single particle can't go through both slits at the same time, can it? Detectors at the slits. If we use detectors so we can see which slit the particle goes through, the interference pattern disappears and we get two peaks corresponding to the detectors. It behaves like a classic particle going through one slit or the other. Well, not quite. In fact, it still gets diffracted, but each slit makes a single slit diffraction pattern. The nonsensical conclusion seems to be that a particle is just a probability that exhibits wave behavior, like interference, until detected, when it pops into existence in a random but definite location. Quantum eraser. So maybe it's the act of detecting the particle that makes it behave in a classical expected way. In the quantum eraser experiment, we place the detectors and then destroy the information they collect. The interference pattern is back, sort of, but the details of the experiments matter. It turns out that the quantum eraser experiment and its relative, the delayed choice quantum eraser, are not that illuminating. I started making animations, but it turns out if you understand the standard double slit experiment, then you pretty much get understanding of the quantum eraser for free. In the interest of brevity, I've removed that section from this video. Sabine Hossenfelder has a good video on the quantum eraser. Instead, I added a section on the bomb experiment. Many YouTube videos present the counterintuitive nature of the double slit experiments in much more detail than this super brief overview. Here is Don Lincoln at Fermilab expressing a somewhat fatalistic sentiment.
Fun fact, I went into physics hoping to solve this quantum conundrum, but as I got into it, I saw just how hard it was. If a century of smart people thinking about it hasn't solved the problem, I probably wasn't going to either. So I went to particle physics, which was equally interesting and a field where I could make a difference, and, well, the rest is history. Even though the double slit experiment is mind-blowing, there's more to the story.
Jeroen from Huygens Optics is an amateur and original thinker interested in the nature of light. Unlike armchair scientists like me, he has a lab with lasers and actually does the experiments. In general, the attitude is that quantum physics is just counterintuitive and weird, and we just have to deal with it because that's the way the world works. Here is Jim Al-Khalili at the end of an introductory lecture on the double slit.
Now, if you can explain this using common sense and logic, do let me know.
We aim to do exactly this, explain it using common sense and logic. If this is possible, why has that not been done already? Well, it does require some mental agility because we're working with three time dimensions, which does take some getting used to. If it was really obvious, somebody else would have worked this out 100 years ago. It helps to have watched videos 1 and or 7 in this series first, because there we explain how multiple time dimensions give rise to parallel timelines that run diagonally through the space and time dimensions. In physics, superposition is regarded as a property of particles, which can be in multiple states at once. In our view, particles are in a definite state in each timeline, and multiple copies of observers in parallel timelines behave in perfect synchronization until different information reaches them and their mind states diverge. So you could see superposition as a property of the observer's minds. Waves and particles are contradictory concepts, and in video 3, 6 ideas, I argue that they're emergent concepts that are mistakenly considered fundamental, what I call turtle-like. What we call particles are eddies in a discrete mathematical vector field and therefore have wave-like properties. This is the origin of wave-particle duality. Each pattern has a center and is countable. For the purpose of illustration in this video, we'll show a particle as a little sphere. The question, what does that single particle interfere with, we can now answer, with the particles in the neighboring timelines. A single timeline corresponds to our classical intuition of the world, where each particle at a certain distance from the origin is only at one point. With two time dimensions, that point becomes a line, sideways in time. With three time dimensions, a plane. There are copies of observers, environment, and particles in each timeline. Three time dimensions is a better fit for our reality, but for illustration purposes, two time dimensions show the principles fine, and it is easier to depict graphically. We're using colored balls instead of actual particles with measurable properties, like electrons with spin or photons with polarization, because it's enough to illustrate the point. Some quantum effects are artifacts of multiple time dimensions and don't require complicated physics to understand. Let's first talk about entanglement. Here we shoot a black particle at a device that splits into two particles, a green one and a red one. In one timeline, the green flies off to the left, in the other way around. We're showing two observers, perfect copies of each other in two timelines. If the observers do not know the state of the particle, and no other differences in their world in their timelines exist, then the mind states of the observer copies will continue to develop in perfect synchronization. When the observers look at the state of one of the particles, then their mind states diverge. In a single time-dimensional view of the world, the particles are in a state of superposition until observed, and entangled, so that observing the state of one instantaneously determines the state of the other. Multiple timelines make the concept of entanglement superfluous. We should also talk about path selection at this stage, which was introduced in the first video. Say we record the state of the particle without telling the observer, or somehow the information whether the red particles on the left or the right leaks out into the environment. The observer's minds are still in sync, so there's no divergence yet, but this selects the path down the timelines that the observer copies are on. To make this clearer, we draw the timelines of the observers as a tree. When the black particle is created, the timelines are identical, and we take this as the root of our tree. Now the black particle is split into a red and a green one. Still, the observers share the same mind state. Were the observers to check the state of the particle, it would appear to them as random, being 50% probability of being red or green, but in reality, both state combinations exist. Now here, information about the state of the particle leaks into the world, for example by recording it with a sensor. But the observer copies are still unaware of this information, so they continue to share the same mind state. For clarity, we color in the subtrees in green and red from now. Now, sometime later, the observers check the state of the particle and their mind states diverge. But not to any state, but of course to the one corresponding to the subtree they're in. The observer in the red subtree sees a red particle, and the one in the green subtree a green one. Translated into single time-dimensional terms, a particle appears to be in superposition, but the superposition disappears, which we call decoherence, when information about its state leaks into the environment. Now we start to apply this to the basic double-slit experiment. When you shoot a single particle through the double-slit, there are copies of it with slightly different paths along the parallel timelines. Again, instead of a superposition in the particles, there is a shared mind state of the copies of the observers, meaning that their brains and therefore their minds operate in perfect synchronization. Only when differing information reaches them, for example when detecting the actual position of the particle, do their mind states diverge and each sees the particle in a specific location. Showing the sideways in time direction like that is intuitively more accurate, but we run out of dimensions when we want to see a second one. Showing it as frames next to each other is simpler, and can be extended to two sideways in time dimensions if necessary. Now let's analyze diffraction from the point of view of multiple time dimensions. Here is a source that fires particles in the general direction of a screen. When it hits the screen, there is a peak of detected particles where the source is aiming, with some variation. Let's call that the single source scenario. We get a similar effect when we fire our black particle source at a single slit. You get single slit diffraction and a similar pattern. When we now introduce a second slit, there is interference and you get multiple peaks with an interference pattern. Even when we send the particles one at a time, we get interference from the particles in neighboring timelines. If, however, we place detectors at the slit, then the mind states of the observers diverge at that point, and the setup in effect simplifies to the single source scenario. We need to bear in mind that the pattern is built up one particle at a time. It isn't like the pattern changes instantly as soon as the observer looks. When the observer does not know the path of a particle, then identical copies of the observer end up in all the timelines that only diverge when the particle is observed on the screen. Recording the position at the slit brings path selection into play. Again, path selection does not make the mind states of the observers diverge. This still only happens when different information reaches them. Path selection selects the path on the timeline tree that the observer can be on. Here is another way of looking at it. What looks like the probability of an event from the perspective of each observer copy is related to the number of timelines in which the event happens. Copies of the observer end up in all subtrees, so this is simultaneously the most and least random thing you can imagine. Totally deterministic when viewed from the outside, totally random from the point of view of each of the observer copies. The particles don't care at all whether they're observed or not. So with or without an observer, you get a diffraction pattern. This is due to the difference in path lengths of the particles that go through the left slit and the one from the neighboring timeline that goes through the right slit. At some points, you get constructive interference and others destructive interference, resulting in the distinctive 5 or 7 bands that make up the diffraction pattern. This is what an observer whose mind state is distributed across all the possibilities experiences. When we have detectors at the slits, we get timeline selection, where the observer copies are fixed to many, many subtrees, one for every different state of the particles detected at the slits. This fixes the path lengths from the slits, and thus each of the many observer copies does not see a diffraction pattern. Interference with neighboring timelines has many applications and will be revisited in a future video. Here's one interesting thought experiment, the bomb experiment. Say you have a set of bombs. Some you can detonate with a single particle, some are duds, and the particle passes through them with no effect. They look identical. How can you sort them and find some that are definitely functional? In a single time dimension, this is impossible. When you try each bomb, either nothing happens, and then you know 100% that it is a dud, or it explodes and is destroyed. In multiple time dimensions, you can rig up an apparatus that uses interference with neighboring timelines to check if the bomb has exploded there, so you can at least certify a portion of your bombs as being definitely functional. Here's how that would work. You need a mechanism that splits off the particle to the left in one timeline and to the right in the other timeline, and a corresponding mechanism that uses interference with a neighboring timeline to merge the particles and therefore detect the existence of a particle in the neighboring timeline. Here is the basic setup. We split the particles so it goes left in one timeline and right in the other. Identical observer copies exist in both timelines. When the particles recombine and interfere with each other, the detector is set up to record this. Now we place the bomb into one of the paths. If it is a dud and the particle travels through the bomb unchanged, the experiment behaves just as before. If it is live, then it explodes in one timeline and not the other. So half of the observer copies see the explosion and lose the bomb, but the other half notice on the final detector that the particle required for the final interference is missing, so they know that the bomb has exploded in the other timeline. Pretty straightforward, but if you try to explain this in the single time dimension, you tie yourself in knots. Here's Sabine Hossenfelder having a go.
And that means quantum mechanics tells you something about the path that the photon didn't take. That's the sense in which quantum mechanics is truly non-local and weird, not because you can't observe the wave function and not because of entanglement, but because it can tell you something about events that didn't happen.
In summary, I want to stress that all this is an explanation using only common sense and logic. We don't postulate weird behavior like entanglement or worry about consciousness collapsing wave functions. We used colored balls for particles to show that most of these effects are natural consequences of multiple time dimensions. What traditional physics calls a wave function and has adopted as a fundamental concept is a turtle, in my opinion. The wave function is a mathematical formula that captures the behavior of a system sideways in time. Is there scope for experiments to test this idea? For a testable prediction, we need to have differences to traditional physics, and luckily there are some. In our explanation, the interference only happens when the particles are closed sideways in time. If we succeeded in separating the particles sideways in time, we should be able to avoid interference. We will revisit this in a later video. I hope you found this interesting. Thanks for your attention.